4. It's a very long scripture. I'll just read a few, and then I want you to follow me as I narrate the story and bring out the relevance of the story in that scripture to us. 1 Samuel chapter 4. Read quickly from verse 1. And the word of Samuel came to all Israel. Now Israel went out against the Philistines to battle and pitched beside Ebenezer. And the Philistines pitched in Aphek. And the Philistines put themselves in array against Israel. And when they joined battle, Israel was smitten before the Philistines, and they slew of the army in the field about 4,000 men. And when the people were coming to the camp, the elders of Israel said, "Wherefore?" That's the question. "Wherefore are the Lord smitting us today before the Philistines? Let us fetch the ark of the covenant of the Lord out of Shiloh unto us, that when he cometh among us, he may save us. He may save us out of the hands of our enemies." So the people sent to Shiloh, that they may bring from thence the ark of the covenant of the Lord of hosts, which dwelleth between the cherubims. And the two sons of Eli, Ophni and Phinehas, were there with the ark of the covenant of God. And when the ark of the covenant of the Lord came into the camp, all Israel shouted with a great shout, so that the ark rang again. And the Philistines heard the noise of the shout. They said, "What meaneth the noise of this great shout in the camp of the Hebrews?" And they understood that the ark of the Lord was coming to the camp. And the Philistines were afraid, for they said, "God is coming to the camp." And they said, "Woe unto us, for there hath not been such a thing heretofore. Woe unto us, who shall deliver us out of the hand of these mighty gods? These are the gods that smote the Egyptians with all the plagues in the wilderness. Be strong and quit yourselves like men, O you Philistines, that ye be not servants unto the Hebrews as they have been to you. Quit yourselves like men and fight." And the Philistines fought, and Israel, can you imagine? Israel again was smitten, and they fled every man into his tent, and there was a very great slaughter, for there fell of Israel 30,000 footmen. And the ark of God was taken, and the two sons of Eli, Ophni and Phinehas, were slain. And there ran a man of Benjamin out of the army and came to Shiloh the same day with his clothes rent and the ark upon his head. And when he came, lo, Eli sat upon a seat by the wayside watching, for his heart trembled for the ark of God. And when the man came into the city and told it, all the city cried out. And when Eli heard the noise of the crying, he said, "What meaneth the noise of this tumult?" And the man came in hastily and told Eli. Now Eli was 98 years old, and his eyes were dim, that he could not see. And the man said unto Eli, "I am he that came out of the army, and I fled today out of the army." And he said, "What is there done, my son?" And the messenger answered and said, "Israel is fled before the Philistines, and there had been also a great slaughter among the people. And thy two sons, Ophni and Phinehas, are dead, and the ark of God is taken." And it came to pass, when he made mention of the ark of God, that he fell from off the seat backward by the side of the gate, and his neck brake. And he died, for he was an old man and heavy, and he had judged Israel 40 years. And his daughter-in-law, Phinehas' wife, was with child, near to be delivered. And when she heard the tidings that the ark of God was taken, and that her father-in-law and her husband were dead, she bowed herself and travailed, for her pains came upon her. And about the time of her death, the women that stood by her said unto her, "Fear not, for thou hast born a son." But she answered not, neither did she regard it. And she named the child Ichabod, saying, "The glory is departed from Israel, because the ark of God was taken, and because of her father-in-law and her husband." And she said, "The glory is departed from Israel, for the ark of God is taken." I want to speak to you this morning on what I call return to the glory. Return to the glory. This is a very pathetic story that mirrors the life of many believers, mirrors the life of the church in a lot of places, mirrors the life of many believers. Bible told us from the beginning of that chapter that the Philistines put themselves to battle Israel. And you need to understand that Israel is not just any nation. Israel is the nation of God. It's like you saying that the devil wants to fight the child of God. And God used to put himself in the battle of Israel such that no matter how big a nation is, you couldn't fight Israel and win Israel. You couldn't. There was no way you could do it. And it wasn't because Israel was sophisticated. It wasn't because Israel had a great army. It was because Israel was a people of covenant. And Israel in the Old Testament is a picture of the believer in the New Testament. There was something called the glory of God that was in Israel, that it didn't matter even if nations were up to six,
We had battles where nations of 4, 5, 6 gathered together. But because the one who is the God of Israel, who refers to himself as the man of war, every time he went to battle on behalf of Israel, it didn't matter how big you are, it didn't matter how sophisticated you are. This was a God that brought out Israel out of the land of Egypt. Egypt was the world power. And he brought the people out of the land of Egypt, took them through the midst of the Red Sea, and delivered their enemies to that same sea. He was mighty in their midst. He led them by a pillar of cloud and a pillar of fire. The dread of Israel was upon the nations around them. Not because they were a mighty people, but because they had a mighty God. And that's the revelation of the life of a believer, that you are not an ordinary person. You could wear anything and look normal, but you are not normal. You are abnormal. You are an alien. There is a supernatural force inside of you. Come on. There is a power behind you that walks around you, such that you are too hot for the enemy to handle. The moment you begin to find out that a believer begins to suffer defeat before his enemies, it's a pointer to the fact that something is wrong. His alignment with the covenant of God, something is wrong with it. So the Philistines pitched their tent and fought. And you know, Israel took it for granted. It was normal that by the covenant of God walking upon Israel, the Bible said to Joshua, God said to him, no man will be able to stand before you all the days of your life. As it was with Moses, it will be with you. So let me say to you that if you have ever had a testimony of what Christianity or Christians used to be, how they used to walk in power, that's what you're supposed to be. History is supposed to help you understand who you are. That you are not just anyone. You are a supernatural being. The God of Israel is your God. So the believer is not an ordinary person. So they went to battle with the Philistines, and he surprised them. 4,000 men were killed. How come that this same Israel began to suffer defeat before the enemies? So they came to a meeting called a conference, and he began to appear as if Israel didn't have a God. He began to appear as if God was no longer alive. So they felt that perhaps let's change that God. If perhaps his presence stood in the temple, let's bring his presence into the battle. So the Bible said they sent to Shiloh and said, let's fetch the ark. They got the ark out of Shiloh and brought the ark to the battle. The day the ark entered the battleground, Bible said there was a shout in the ark. The ark itself rang. Because they understood that God in the midst of them is a mighty and terrible one. The believer must understand that God in you, Bible says, Christ in you, the hope of glory. There is something about your life. In the day that it matters, God always shows up for a believer that is in alignment. You cannot suffer shame like somebody who does not have God. So when the ark came into the battleground, the Bible says the people shouted with a great shout that the ark rang. Even the Philistines knew that something happened in the camp of the Hebrews. The Philistines said, woe unto us. Is this not the same God? They knew that God came into the camp. They said, woe unto us. So imagine that your enemy already said, woe to him, because he just heard your shout. And they said, is this not the same God that destroyed the Egyptians? So God had a track record. I love the guy who sang that God has a track record. And he's not about to change it now. God does not change. God is always constant. In every generation, the Bible says from eternity to eternity, he is God. From everlasting to everlasting does not change. So when you begin to see that the possibilities around the life of a believer does not relate to what God used to be, the problem is not with God. The problem is with that believer. The problem has never been with God. It has always been with people who are not in alignment with the God of their covenant. So they put the battle in array again. Everybody was confident. Their ginger was back, you know. And they went to battle with the Philistines. Unfortunately, they suffered a greater defeat. In the first battle, it was 4,000 men that died. In the second battle, it was 30,000 men that died. I can imagine what it was in the camp of the Israelites that day. You see, in the first place, they should have understood that something critically was wrong with them. You practically didn't need to carry the ark to the battle. You didn't need to. The God of Israel, you couldn't trap him in a place. Of course, the ark was a representation of his presence within them, but he was mighty in them, such that even without carrying the ark to battle, he would deliver victory to them. So something
was wrong with the alignment and they did not pay attention to it. So 30,000 men were destroyed, they were killed, and they began to wander. So from this scripture, what I found out is that, you see, up until the time of the battle, Israel was not paying attention to that covenant. And this is the situation of a lot of believers. We are God users, not God chasers. Believers want God to show up for them in the day of battle, but they don't show up for God on a normal day. Believers want God who will do, you know, like a magician or a firefighter who will show up in your house when there is fire. But when there was no fire, nobody paid attention to that God. And God is saying, I am tired of being used. You cannot continue to use me. The God of Israel was not there. The God of Israel was not busy. The God of Israel was not sleeping. He was alive, even as he's alive evermore. So the question is, how come that he did not deliver victory to them when it mattered most? How come that they couldn't, you know, manifest the glory of that God in the day of battle? So the ark didn't make any difference. To make matters worse, even the ark was captured in the battle. Come on now. To make matters worse, I mean, maybe I need to tell you a little bit about the ark. The ark is what God used to capture the essence of his glory amongst men. The history of this ark is so mighty and terrible that when they dedicate and God comes, the glory will fill the atmosphere. You didn't need anybody to tell you that God was around. But that same ark, the point I'm making is, you can be a believer and have God and yet suffer like somebody who does not have God. Why? Because your alignment with that God is not correct, and I'm going to show you. The alignment of Israel with that God was not correct. So the ark was captured. The priests, Ophni and Phinehas, who were the sons of Eli, they were killed. The ark was taken away. Somebody ran out of the battle, brought the news to Eli, and, you know, told the news in Israel. Everybody wept. Came to Eli. Eli was 98 years old. What happened, my son? He said, something terrible happened in the battle today. Apart from the fact that your sons were killed, the ark of the covenant was taken away. When the guy had it, he fell down from his chair and died. That was the high priest of Israel. Now, the Bible said that there was this lady, the wife of one of the sons of Eli, the wife of Phinehas, who was pregnant. And when she also had the news, she just entered labor. She just entered labor. When she delivered and they said, you have a baby boy, I said, that's not important. In fact, let me show you that this time, this part is a terrible part. You see, the moment you lose your standing before God, what you give back to is called Ichabod. And the word Ichabod means the glory has departed. The people who used to operate under glory came to a point when the glory was no longer with them. You would have thought that it was the day the ark was taken from them that the ark was taken, but the ark was taken from them a long time ago. They had the physical ark, but the spiritual ark was not with them. The presence of God was not with them, and the reason for which God departed from Israel and his manifest presence no longer worked for them, you will see it in chapter 2 and chapter 3. If you go back to 1 Samuel chapter 2 and chapter 3, you will see how the Bible says the priests of Israel were treating God. And let me help you understand that, you see, we are priests and kings. Revelation chapter 1 verse 6, he said he has made us kings and priests unto our God and his Father. So when you add in the Old Testament, you are just a tribe of priests. They were the tribe of Levi. But the very intention of God was for all Israel to be priests. In the New Testament, there is no single tribe that is called the tribe of Levi. Everybody is a priest. You may not carry the title of a pastor, but you are a minister of the New Testament. We no longer have one Moses that goes to talk to the Father and comes to speak with us. No, Jesus already opened it and brought all of us in. It's an economy of access. Everybody now has access to God, and you are a minister unto God. So if you attend a church and it does not give you the revelation of the fact that you are supposed to have a personal relationship with God, it's doing you a disservice. Of course, when you give back to the child, you can help that child and begin to support. But as soon as the child grows up, If I want to travel the world right now, I don't need to tell my mom. The time was when I couldn't go out of our house without getting permission. But you come to maturity. That's why God wants to bring all of us to maturity, so that you can minister to Him directly without passing through anyone. We all come through Jesus. So God is not a grandfather. God is a direct father. That's why the Bible says we now have the spirit. We don't have the spirit of fear, but we have the spirit of adoption. Whereby we cry, Abba Father, not our grandfather. So you cannot continue to pass through your pastor. The only time you hear the word of God is when you come to church. That's not good Christianity. In the day of your battle, you expect God to show up, but He will not show up. That's the point I'm going to. In the day when your peculiarity, 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 9, you are a chosen generation, a peculiar people, a royal priesthood. The reason why I've called you out of darkness into my marvelous light is that you may show forth the praises of me who called you out of darkness. So what God wants to do with the life of every believer, as He was doing with Israel in the Old Testament, is to make you a spectacle, not of shame, but a spectacle of glory. God wants to write a story with your life that when people look at you, they wonder what a wonder you are. They wonder what a wonder you are. You are a star in the midst of darkness that people will look at you and say, there is darkness all over the earth, but this woman is shining. All other people are breaking down, but this one is going up. Their life is not making sense, but this one is making sense. That's the picture God wants to paint with our life. That's what He was doing with Israel, a small nation, even until today. All the big nations, if you don't recognize Israel, you're on your own. Indestructible. You can attack it, but He has technology that is far ahead of yours. He can intercept your missiles in the air. Nations have to copy Him. A small nation in the midst of enemy nations, yet they cannot conquer. Even the collaboration of those enemies cannot conquer Him. And that's just physical Israel. How about the spiritual Israel? Why do we suffer defeat like we don't have God? It's because something is wrong with our priesthood. The Bible said about Eli in 1 Samuel chapter 2 and chapter 3, Eli and his sons, that they were so careless and complacent about priesthood that they began to serve God anyhow. Let me say to you that, you see, God is such a great God that you can't worship Him anyhow. God is too big that you relate with Him like, you know, just somebody. God is extra on your schedule. If I have extra time, I will deal with you, you know. You can't deal with God like that and expect Him to show up for you in the day that it matters. And let me say to you, every believer will come to a day of battle with the Philistines. Every believer will have an evil day that God needs to show up for you. And what determines whether He will show up for you is whether you have been showing up for Him. Is somebody hearing what I'm talking about? We are ministers in His temple. So you cannot be absent without leave. You're living your day normally, every day of your life. But in the day of battle, you now go and come, you go and bring up Jeremiah chapter 33 verse 3 and say, "Call unto me, and I will show you." He will show you nada. You won't see nothing. If you see anything, you will see your picture. Because you have the responsibility. This gospel is a gospel of responsibility. God has done His part. You are the one to do your part. If He appears that God is not showing up for you, He's speaking a parable to you. Look inwards. The problem is not outside. The problem is inside. They were abandoned in the battlefield. They were like sheep without shepherd. Their God, who used to fight for them, didn't show up. Very unlike God. But the problem was within. A people who were absent from their priesthood. They only go to church on Sunday, but Monday to Saturday, they don't have fellowship with God. The only time they read the Bible is when the pastor is reading it on the altar. And they expect to carry the glory. The glory cannot come like that. It doesn't work like that. The moment you shake in the place of your responsibility as a priest, the glory cannot attend. Every time you see fire, there is sacrifice on the altar. And Romans 12 says you should now make yourself a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable. If you get back home, I want you to read 1 Samuel chapter 2, read 1 Samuel chapter 3. The priesthood of Eli, the priesthood of Hophni and Phinehas, he was so terrible, they were doing despicable deeds. They were a picture of a New Testament believer who has been saved, that has eternal life, but is living outside of eternal life. These were the people who commit sacrifice. They come to church, they just do anyhow. They treat God with disdain. They carry their life about as if God is not involved. Have you heard people say, it's my life, I can do anything with it? That's not the life of a priest. I don't have the time to expose to you the regimented life of a priest. The priest is called to the life of ministry to God. You see, they told us when we were growing up as Christians that you are a royal priesthood, but nobody told us the responsibility of priests. Priest is a calling. Priesthood is a calling. And if you go and read Leviticus chapter 6, you will see that the priests had to go into the presence of God every day. Make sure that there was fire upon the altar of sacrifice. Priesthood is not a title, it's a mantle. You needed to be responsible to show up before God. So people want God to show up for them, but they don't show up for God. God says pray, no, they don't pray. God says I need praises, they don't praise him. But in the day of battle, they will not lift up their voice. You know, Yoruba people have a word that you did not stone, is it coconut? You did not stone something, you didn't tap and wine, but you not lift up your mouth like this. You are like, why should fall? There is no magic that will make wine fall. You must do your own part. These guys abuse the sacrifice of God. Bible says they even slept with women at the gate of the temple. It's a picture. I don't have the time to begin to break it down. So you are talking about a believer who commits fornication, but is still saying to God, show up for me in the day of battle. You are talking about a believer who does not have devotion, who does not have consecration, but he's still saying, God is going to sort me out. God is not stupid. Galatians 6:17. He said, God is not mocked. Don't be deceived. Whatever a man sows, that shall he reap. The people who saw the hand of God manifested in their generation, they paid the price for it. They sought the face of God, not the hand of God. We have a generation of believers who only seek the hand of God, but they don't want to see the face of God. Because the face of God cannot even behold iniquity. So if you are a sinner, you can't be seeking his face. The best you can do is to be seeking his hand and say, God bless me. And the job of the priest is not to seek the hand of God. The job of the priest is to minister to God. So God is saying to us this morning, I have not changed. I am the God of Israel. That same ark that was taken, you needed to read further and see this ark that pretended as if he was dead, like he was an egg wire. When they put that ark in the hands of that God, the guy woke up. Just on my integrity, I just want to show these guys who took me that I am not a dead God. So in the camp of the enemy, he was cutting asunder, biting and chewing. Even their God broke his head, broke his hand. The guy prostrated. When they came up, they brought the God, called that God, they brought it up. The second day, the guy was down. You're standing before the God of Israel. You don't know what I'm talking about. But that was the same God that was silent in the battle of his people. How is it that he looks in your life that God is not alive? How is it that he appears in your situation that God is asleep? He never travels. He doesn't go on trips. He's omniscient, omnipresent, all-knowing, almighty. When the people who tend to him, who minister to him as priests, when they call him, he shows up. He never puts to shame. Acts chapter 3 says, on the day of prayer, these guys were going to, that's to tell you that they were priests. Even after they were baptized with the Holy Ghost, they were still going to the temple at the hour of prayer. And then they saw one man that was lame. He said, you get up. God said to me, I'm about to release my power upon my people such that in your workplace you will do miracles. And you are thinking, oh, the error has gone. No, God is saying, I'm still the same God. I do wonders without number. Wonders, that's what I do. My specialty is that I manifest glory. But the moment a people miss out from their priesthood, shame is what they manifest. Israel was shamified. Is there a grammar like that? Israel, they were shamified in that battle. And even the Philistines will be surprised. Because the Philistines had the gist of what happened to Herod and to Pharaoh. The world power, God messed up Herod. Did you remember the plagues in Egypt? That was the God of Israel at work. All the plagues, Bible says, by the blast of his nostrils, the Red Sea stood one to this side, one to this side. The people walked on dry ground. And when the enemy came into it, he baptized them, gave them water baptism by force. They died, not remaining one. All the hosts of Pharaoh. That's the God we serve. The God who can pull down Jericho without using caterpillar. He is alive, he's always there. But the people who will see his manifested glory must attend to their priesthood. God cannot be one that you relate with in your extra time. When you are done with Netflix, you are done with YouTube, you are done with Facebook, you are done with Instagram, you are done with what else? WhatsApp and TikTok. And so when you are now about to sleep, and you are already yelling, Father. Why are you laughing as if you are the one I'm talking to? Have mercy upon us. Your angel will be looking at you like, look at this man. In the day of your battle, you will understand that you have been irresponsible in your priesthood. You live your life anyhow, flaunt all his commandments, do the things that he said you should not do. But when you are now ready to settle down, you say, Father, where is the bone of my bone and the flesh of my flesh? He's looking at you. This cow bone here. Or chicken bone. What are you talking about? Even if you are a child and you decide to be irresponsible to your parents, they will be looking at you. The prodigal son took a walk and walked away. The father was always loving. The father was always rich, but he never sent food to him out there. Same God, same father. Rich, merciful, loving. He was waiting for that guy to return back to his senses. But in the meantime, he suffered for it. Oh, we're quick to say when he came back, God, the father put a ring on him. But did you count his loss? All the time he was eating the food of pigs, a prince was eating the food of pigs. So a believer can suffer shame. A believer can live in reproach and suffer ridicule if he does not understand that God has a responsibility for him that he must attend to. The place of prayer, the place of worship, we don't see you there. The place of the study of the word of God, we don't see you there. You do your job 8 hours, but you never find time to do evangelism. All of that is the business of your father. You never attend to it. You treat God like extramarital affair. God is not looking for a one-night stand. God is not looking for a quickie. God is looking for a relationship. God is looking for a relationship 24/7. But he's never asleep. 1 Kings chapter 18. Elijah came out from his hiding place. You see, people manifest glory when they be responsible in their secret place. Glory does not just attend an empty shout. These people shouted when the ark came, but the ark didn't work. Your shout does not impress God. It is your life that impresses God. Your shout doesn't impress him. God is not boo-booed by your makeup and acting. He knows you inside out. So Elijah came up and said, before the Lord whom I stand, that's a man who has a standing in the secret place of the Most High. The reason why God will honor his word in the public is because he has honored the word of God in the private. Let them know it. The heavens shut. He went back 3.5 years. He was doing personal fellowship. The real Christian life is not church, it's personal life. The real Christian life is personal life. If the only time you are a Christian is when you are in church, you are not a Christian. After 3.5 years, God will say, shh, show up, let's go and do something. And then the guy will show up. He said, tell your king, Obadiah, tell your king to meet me on Mount Carmel. I want to show him that there is a God in Israel. Your life will manifest God. Your life will testify of the goodness of God. When you stand, what the Lord said to me is that you have entered into a realm of glory. God wants to show himself, but he's looking for priests. It is priests that usher in the glory. Stewards of his presence. Men who fast not because they are looking for a car, they fast because they are looking for God. He came to Abraham and said, I am your shield and exceeding great reward. Abraham said, why will you give me baby? He said, forget. Maybe it's a small thing. Take me first. If you have me, you have all things. And then Elijah will show up and said, call your prophets of Baal, 400 or 450 of them. Let's take 2 bullocks. Everybody should call his own God. If you think that you are God, call him today. Me, I also. Can you get to that point in your Christian life when people start arguing whether there is Jesus or not Jesus? You say, leave argument. Bring a crippled man. Let us show. That's the red God wants to take. You see, grammar will not change Canadians. How many of you know that? If you ever have it in your mind that you will speak grammar and people will give their life, it's not going to happen. It's power. And that power comes by a private life of communion with God. So, he's give me a blind man. You, tell your God to open his eyes. If he open, we will serve him. If mine open his eyes, we will serve mine. Do we have a deal? They say, yes. Then that's it. That settles it. Said a man went to India to preach, called all the priests of other gods in India and said they should attend the conference, his crusade. They came. So they said there was one man who didn't have eyes at all. He didn't have eyes. So he brought the guy out and said, all the priests of other gods, they should come and tell their God to give this guy eyes. If he can give him eyes, we will serve your gods. But if not, we will serve my own. They did all they could do, nothing happened. He called eyes down, told the eyes, don't enter quickly. Stay on his head for 5 seconds so that people can see that there is a spare part factory in heaven. After 5 seconds, he now said, eyes enter, the eyes enter. People, what are you talking about? What are you talking about? Your God is alive. He's not saying, seek me, seek me, seek me. Don't do religion. This is not a religion. This is an active life of the Spirit. There is a God in your inside. He's sleeping. You know that Jesus can sleep in the boat of your life? He was in the boat of the disciples and he was asleep. As if he was not there. And the storm rocked them after messing up themselves. They now remember, God is here. He said, let's go and wake bros up. When they woke him up, he said, I didn't know you wake me up. So it means that even if the storm will carry them away, the guy will be silent. He cannot be carried away by a storm, but he will just be there chilling. I want you to hunger and thirst for him. He's real. I have touched him. I know he's alive. It's not the testimony of a third party that makes me serve God. I have touched his essence, his power. You need to come to that realm where he becomes real to you personally. We won't need to beg you to come to church. We won't need to. He's real. He's alive. Can you stand up to your feet this morning? Can you stand up to your feet this morning? And I want you to return to that place of active fellowship with the Lord. We are not playing. It's not because we want to gather people that we are doing church. No, sir. We want to show God to people so that they can know him for themselves. That's the reality of the Christian experience. You know him for yourself. Can you lift up your hands to him this morning and just come back to him? The Bible says the prodigal son came to his senses and said, Lord, I'm sorry we're not taking a walk away from you. I return to you this morning. I return to you this morning. If there are scores to settle with God, this is a good time to settle. And if you are here and you are watching me online or you are in the house, you are not giving your life to Christ, this is a good time to say, Lord, I'm sorry for living in reproach all these days. I want to return to glory. There was a glory that Adam had in the beginning. Before he became naked, real nakedness is not that you don't have clothes in your wardrobe. It's that God is absent in your life. The reality of God is not seen in you. Say, Lord, I return to you this morning. I return to you this morning. I return to you this morning. I want to quit playing games. I want to touch your essence. I want to touch your reality. I want to see your glory. That glory in the ark. That glory in the temple. That glory as of the begotten Son. I want to see you. I want to touch you. I want to live your days. Come on now. Can somebody go ahead and pray in the Holy Ghost this morning? Say, Father, let the reality of your glory become my experience. Let the reality of your glory become my experience. Let it become palpable. Let it become evident that my God is alive. Let my life become a testimony of a living God. Let my life become a testimony of the goodness of God. Let my life become a testimony of the reality of God. That I've called you, that you may show forth the praises of him who called you out of darkness. Am I showing his praise or am I showing his shame? I don't want to show a shame, Lord. Let your glory come and fill this temple. Can you rededicate your life to God this morning? And say, I don't want to be a priest like Ophini. I don't want to be a priest like Eli. I don't want to be a priest like Phineas. Men who treated God with disdain. Men who didn't have respect for the covenant. A generation of people that didn't know God. And yet they expected him to show up in their battle. Say, Lord, I dedicate myself to you. I am yours, O God.
Are you withholding your life from Him? Say, Lord, I surrender all to you this morning. I surrender all to you this morning. And I return to you. I return to the place of fellowship. He came to the church in Revelation. He said, I have a few things against you. He said, but return to the place of your first love. Return to the place where you met me at the beginning. God came to Jacob and said, return to Bethel and build me an altar there. Return to Bethel. And I want you to make up your mind to live with Jesus consciously on a daily basis. Consciously, it's not only when you are trying to sleep. It should permeate your thought, permeate your life. From the first breath in the morning when you open your eyes to the last one you took before you slept, God should be in your life. Say, Lord, I return. And I surrender all to you this morning. I surrender to you. Come and lift up your hands and worship Him this morning. Everything I give to you. With all and nothing. With all and nothing. Say, I surrender. I surrender to you. Everything, Lord, everything I need to you. With all and nothing, with all and nothing, with all. Thank you for the ministry of your word to us. Thank you for calling us back to yourself, to responsible priesthood. Thank you for stirring up your fire in our bones. Thank you for calling us to return to the path of glory. We return to you this morning. We rededicate ourselves to you this morning. We say, Lord, accept us. Accept us and help our determination. Help our decisions for you this morning. That from this day onward, your glory will begin to manifest in our lives. We will begin to radiate your glory. And people will see the evidence that we serve the living God. Thank you, Heavenly Father. We give you all the praise and glory. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Come on, somebody say, Lord, amen. Please take your seat. I believe that God spoke to you this morning. I want you to please find time. Just take up time. Read 1 Samuel. Read from chapter 1. Beautiful story. But the revelation behind some of the things in there is what I just shared with you. Glory be to the name of the Lord. I want us to package an offering unto the Lord this morning. Let's package an offering. Make it special. It's our Thanksgiving Sunday. You see, like I said, if you begin to know God for yourself personally, we wouldn't need to compel you to do anything. You will give to Him out of the fact that you know Him. You know Him. If you know Him, the way you will give to Him is different than somebody saying, ah, come and do your visitor. Come and do something. No, no, no. You know Him, so you celebrate Him. If you are watching us online and you want to send it, you can send to triumphantnationtoronto@gmail.com. triumphantnationtoronto@gmail.com. So it's great. The last Sunday of the month, and then God is going to be taking us into the new month. We'll take a couple of announcements, and then I'll be back to close the service. God bless you.
To welcome everyone again to church. This is Triumphant Nation Toronto, and we're glad that you're fellowshipping with us this morning, and we believe that you have been greatly blessed by God's word. All right, as a church, we meet every Sunday between the hours of 10 to 12 noon at Jam Rehearsal Studio, 40 Lepage Court, North York, N3J22. So please, if you're ever, for those joining us online, you're ever in the GTA access, please do fellowship with us on Sundays. All right, we pray every Saturdays as a church between the hours of 9 to 10 p.m. Eastern Time on Zoom. It's a time where we just come together to seek the face of God, you know, on corporate and personal issues. So please join us this coming Saturday by 9 p.m. for another time in God's presence. A lot of us haven't been joining. Please let's, you know, put it in our, on our reminders so that we can be a part of this. It's always a beautiful time in God's presence, and God answers our prayers. So please join us this coming Saturday. And we also have the Mondays Online Global Service for Triumphant Nation Everywhere. That holds every Monday between the hours of 1 to 2 p.m. And it's on Facebook at our pastor's page, Albert Ojuwole, every Monday between 1 and 2 p.m. All right? Can we welcome Pastor Toby, even as we take the benediction?
Praise the Lord. Let's rise up to our feet this morning. Okay. Let's lift up our voices and our hands to God this morning and just give Him praise. Can you take a moment and just worship Him in your own language, in your own way? Just show your appreciation. The last Sunday of the seventh month, can you give Him praise this morning? He's been a faithful God. All the way, He's been faithful. He's been a good God to us. Good God, good God, good God to us.